I'll go ahead and call the committee meeting to order due to the termination of the State of Nevada Executive Department Declaration of Emergency Directive 006. As of May 31st, 2021, in-person attendance will be allowed consistent with the CDC guidelines. In accordance with the Declaration of Emergency Directive 047, individuals shall be required to cover their nose and mouth with a mask or a face covering in a manner consistent with the guidance issued by the CDC and any subsequent guidance issued by the CDC. Please check www.cdc.gov for additional information. To make it easier for residents to voice their comments, there'll be two public comment periods. There'll be one at the beginning of the meeting designated for comments related to items on the agenda and one at the end of the meeting for general public comments. Speakers will be limited to 3 minutes to state their comments. This meeting is being video recorded and streamed live to the web. Mr. Valdez, please confirm posting and roll call.
Mayor, this meeting has been posted in accordance with the Nevada Open Meeting Law. All members of the council are present and you have a quorum.
Thank you. Now is the time set aside for the first public comment period. If you wish to make a public comment, please come to the podium and state your name and zip code. You'll be given 3 minutes to speak, and this is for the committee meeting. Is there anyone wishing to speak at the committee meeting? Seeing no one, we'll close the public comment period. Mr. Derrick, are there any changes to the agenda?
There are no changes, Your Honor.
May I have a motion to accept the agenda as presented? There's a motion on the floor. Just have to bring up the screen. Please vote. You want me to take a voice vote? Oh, okay. Please vote.
Might be noted that we have an intern running the computer for us today.
Oh, okay.
All right. Yeah, shut his mic off.
Yeah.
And he is absolutely correct about that, Mayor. All members vote in favor of Councilwoman Romero's motion, and that motion carries.
Thank you.
Item number one is Bill number 3562, 2021-2022 Ward Map. Your recommendation is referred to regular meeting.
Okay.
Mr. Valdez.
Ready? Okay, good afternoon, Mayor. Louis Valdez, City Clerk. I am going to present to you with regard to Bill number 3562, asking for a referral to the regular meeting, establishing the 2021-2022 ward maps for the City of Henderson. A couple of things to review. Section 1.040 of the Henderson City Charter entitled Ward Creation Boundaries reads the city must be divided into four wards, which must be as nearly equal in population as can be conveniently provided, and the territory comprising each ward must be contiguous. So I'm going to show the overhead both of these maps. We have two plans that are on the agenda for your consideration. Plan number one, which is on the overhead right now, the ward stretches west to Gibson Road and north of Horizon Ridge Parkway. And ward number four moves north to Warm Springs Road between Green Valley Parkway and Arroyo Grande. So this is plan number one. This particular plan is one that provides for a significant amount of future growth, but it is one that differs very, very little from the second plan, which is what we will present next to you here on the overhead. Plan two moves ward number one south and west of Horizon Ridge Parkway, and ward number four moves north of the Union Pacific Railroad between Green Valley Parkway and Arroyo Grande Boulevard. A couple of things to keep in mind. Just wanted to make sure that they were clear for the record. Each of the council members' addresses has been confirmed inside their wards for each of the two plans before you. Boundaries of wards must be changed whenever population in any ward exceeds the population in any other ward by 5%. And ward changes must be made 6 months prior to the deadline for a candidate to declare a declaration of candidacy. Now, the reason that these are coming to you today is because there was the late release of the data from the US Census to the states, which was then released to the counties, in our case, Clark County, and our demographer, Andrew Powell, did not receive the information, unfortunately, until probably very early September, if not mid to late September, which is then how we put those two plans together, and they are before you now. I know that there has been a question about which particular plan is recommended by staff. We think plan two is the one that adheres closely, most closely, I should say, to what the charter requires, but ultimately that's a decision for mayor and council to make. And so that is our presentation, and Andrew is here in the audience if you have any technical questions, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you may individually have about the two plans that have been presented.
Questions or comments?
Really, the purpose today is just to refer this to
the regular meeting.
Regular meeting, right?
That's correct.
This is just an introduction.
This is just an introduction, and we wanted to make sure you had that information in front of you.
So there'll be opportunity for the public to provide input to these, and that they'll be available for them in the clerk's office to review.
Correct. Okay. And they're also available online.
Is it right now? Or is it?
Okay, so we want them to select the plan right now. So then, Mayor, we respectfully request then that the council consider which of the plans you want to select. We've recommended plan number two. Ultimately, however, as I mentioned earlier, it's your.
As I look at the motion that's in front of me, it says make a motion to refer. So are we referring it to the regular meeting where then that conversation would occur in the regular meeting?
Yes, Mayor and Council, this would be your opportunity to consider and debate this item and which of the two plans, with your motion being to refer one of the two plans to the regular meeting for adoption.
Oh, okay.
Oh, okay.
So maybe we should talk about what the differences are between these two maps. And I don't know if Andy, maybe you might want to come forward
Powell,
and talk about.
I could ask Mr. Powell to come up.
Well, how are map one and map two differing?
All right, yeah, there are fairly subtle differences between the two. And for the record, Andrew Powell, Community Development Services. In plan one, which I'll put back on top here, as Louis mentioned, the changes primarily are in both circumstances, essentially ward four and ward one need to take on population, and ward two and ward three need to shed some population in order to bring the wards back into balance. So in plan one, ward one stretches to the west a little bit, stays south of the 215, and ward four moves up north of the UPR railroad spur and along as far as Warm Springs. We tried to keep them contiguous and tried to use natural boundaries to the extent possible. This plan is different from plan two in that it provides a little more for some future growth. We tried to balance the areas that we expect will grow more in the future so that it decreases the chance a little bit more that we will need to redistrict again after the next election cycle, but it is still within the confines of the city charter. Conversely, plan two has just slightly less change in plan one. There are five precincts that change wards versus plan two, where there are only four that change wards. In ward one, the way we were able to accomplish that is by having ward one move south and west of Horizon Ridge, and ward four does the same general thing. It moves up north of UPRR a little bit, but less of it goes up to Warm Springs, essentially. So there's a little less change there. It brings the wards closer to imbalance. The reason why plan two has been recommended by staff is that the charter does say that we will bring the wards as close to equal in population as is practical, and this is the plan that accomplishes that. So that is the advantage to this of the two plans. So the one provides a little bit more for future growth. Two brings us as close as possible to agreeing with our city charter's stipulations.
Available then for public input? They were posted on our web.
Yes, that is correct. And they were introduced at the last council meeting two weeks ago as well, and there was public comment at that meeting as well.
Here. You have a question?
Yes. Yeah, and I know this is an impossible question to answer, but really the difference, if I'm hearing you correctly, is kind of planning for future growth, and so maybe we won't have to go through this exercise quite so soon?
Yeah, it is certainly possible that depending on the pace of growth, we might still need to redistrict after the next election cycle, regardless of which plan is chosen. But there is probably less of a chance that we would need to do that under Plan 1 versus Plan 2.
So really we're balancing, it's more equal, Plan 2, versus more in line with what the charter wants us to accomplish, and Plan
Correct.
1 gives us a little more future growth.
Correct. And in both instances as well, we did look at some other measures that are important to redistricting processes. We looked to make sure that compactness of the wards is something that's always considered in terms of looking at whether it's possible that there's some gerrymandering occurring or something like that. In both cases, the wards are more compact under these future plans versus what they are today, so we're improving in that way. One of the interesting things that came out of the Census Bureau, the decennial census this time, was that we now have a minority-majority ward, meaning that more than 50% of the population is a minority in Ward 1. In both of these cases, that is still the case. It's 50.1% today. Under these, it'll be either 50.5 or I believe it's 50.6 or maybe 50.4. It's, you know, within 0.1% difference between the two. So we looked at both of those things. We looked at other groups as well to make sure that we weren't drastically altering the makeup of any of the wards. And we tried to make as few changes as was necessary in order to bring things into balance.
It's minority majority.
Correct.
Okay.
One quick, I'm sorry.
Well, would you put the map up again, please?
Okay. What do I need to hit?
What
are we looking at? This is Plan 2. Is there one in particular you'd like to see?
How much growth potential is there in Ward 4?
Ward 4 is a challenge in terms of growth potential in any scenario, really, because of the ways, the precincts that are small enough that we can move them in a convenient manner and still maintain balance. There is not a whole lot of growth potential, to be perfectly honest, in Ward 4, outside of potential redevelopment would be.
You do, your biggest growth is going to be in 2 and 3.
Correct. Right. That is likely. With one, you know, with what's happening in the downtown, we see some potential certainly there as well, and some stuff down around the college. But yes, definitely 2 and 3 are likely, and that's why in both scenarios they are both slightly larger. Even in Plan 2, wards 2 and 3, we tried to give a little margin for that as well.
Is it if Ward 4 is landlocked basically? In the next go around, you're going to probably have to change borders anyway, because 3 and 4 are going to, or 3 and 2 are going to grow that much.
Right, that is certainly possible.
Okay.
A couple of quick questions. When we do these things, I'm always concerned about natural boundaries and
seed
boundaries. In Ward 2, the crosshatched area. Immediately to the right, you have taken part of Ward 2 and given it to Ward 1. Is that portion that has been awarded to Ward 1 still within McDonald Ranch?
I believe so. I'm not 100% certain, to be honest. I could get the answer to that.
McDonald Ranch, which has... not that it matters, but has one master HOA and all that kind of stuff.
Correct.
So I would want to think about that a little bit. And then the other question I've got is that at some point in time, there's a high probability that the city is going to annex more ground, whether that is adjacent to Ward 1 or adjacent to Ward 2. When that happens, does that automatically necessitate redistricting?
No, it would not, unless those areas that were annexed had a significant amount of population and it was a non-election year.
Okay.
So is there a reason why the hash mark out at Lake Las Vegas is that way?
Yes, that is because that is a pre-election precinct where a sitting council person lives, and that one cannot change wards.
How big your house is.
Yeah, that's good.
it's for the big all of Lake Las Vegas is one election.
Where the big boy lives.
You asked for that, John.
Sure, absolutely.
Yeah, but not that it matters, but I think having them all in one, I think makes a little bit of a difference.
I agree. I think that would be too choppy to have one development being in two districts. It makes it more difficult to kind of address their any concerns they might have. To me, this one seems like it's more fluid, and there's more natural boundaries that just make sense rather than just kind of cutting into the other one. So, and if it provides for growth as well, I think that's the one that I would prefer.
I would agree.
Does this one still maintain the minority majority, whether it's one or two? Okay. All right.
Just a question on those lines, the minority majority. What is the law or regulation or?
There's no law that governs it. It's just something that is can become an area of concern if there is a minority majority district, and redistricting removes that district from having that situation. And neither of these would do that.
One, it sounds like, is just.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So.
I think I would probably be more comfortable with one because the road divides the wards, and I'm not going to end up with a split ward boundary and within a master plan community.
Do you want to make that?
I'll make that motion to refer map number one to move on up.
All right, so we have a motion on the floor moved by Councilman Shaw. Please vote.
All members voted in favor of Councilman Shaw's motion, and that motion passes unanimously.
And thank you very much, Louie, and to Community Development, Andy Powell, and to your teams for analyzing this information and bringing it back to us today in a cogent way. And we appreciate that, and we appreciate the residents of Henderson also participating in the 2020 census that allowed us to have the most accurate numbers we could. In fact, I believe our response rate was 76.1%, which we were the fourth highest in the nation among urban cities. So we appreciate the work that you did to make sure that happened, but also how important this is in terms of allocating resources in our community.
Mayor, I'm sorry, probably a little bit out of line, but just one last question. When was the last time we did this? I'm just trying.
10 years, is it?
Is it like every other year?
So prior to each general election that happens. Now, keep in mind that we are moving to a even numbered year election, right. So it has been some time.
Okay.
Since that happened.
So it's kind of probably every couple of years we do this.
Depending upon the population and how it unfolds, yes.
Andy, are you aware of the last time?
2018 is the data.
2018, okay.
Thank you. Sorry, it's a little out of order there.
Thank you. Cheers. So that motion passed. Mr. Derrick.
Item number two is bill number 3563, zone change ZCA-202-100-8080 for Boulder Roberts. Your recommendation is refer to regular meeting.
Mayor and members of council, this item is the ordinance for the rezoning from MC corridor community mixed use to RS8 low density residential for the Beezer single family subdivision at Boulder and Roberts that was approved at your last meeting.
Thank you. Any questions or comments or feedback from council? I have a motion to refer.
I'll move to refer.
There's a motion on the floor. Please vote.
All members voted in favor of Councilman Stewart's motion, and that motion passes unanimously.
Item number three is bill number 3564, zone change amendment ZCA-201-900-2873-A1 for Amigo Multifamily. Your recommendation is refer to regular meeting.
Ms. Corrado.
Mayor and members of council, this item is the ordinance to apply City of Henderson zoning, RM16, to 5 acres of property with no established zoning for the Amigo multifamily development at Via Centro and East Larson Lane that was approved at your last meeting.
Thank you. Any questions or comments? Can I have a motion to refer? We have a motion on the floor. Please vote.
Mayor, all members voted in favor of Councilwoman Romero's motion, and that motion passes unanimously.
Item number four is Bill number 3565, Zone Change, ZCA-202-100-7869, for Wat Nevada Thararam. Your recommendation is referred to regular meeting.
Mayor and members of council, this item is the ordinance to apply City of Henderson zoning, PS, public, semi-public, to 2.5 acres of property with no established zoning at 12970 Gillespie Street. That was approved at your last meeting.
Thank you. Any questions or comments? Can I have a motion to refer? We have a motion on the floor. Please vote.
All members vote in favor of Councilman Stewart's motion, and that motion passes unanimously.
Thank you. And now is the time set aside for our final public comment period. If you wish to make a public comment, please come to the podium, give your name and your zip code, and you'll have 3 minutes to speak. And again, this is for the committee meeting. Seeing no one, we'll go ahead and close public comment, and I'll go ahead and adjourn the committee meeting at this time, and we'll begin shortly with the regular meeting.
Good stuff, right?